Thank you very much, John. Yes, and John, we have a few of similar issues, but I'm actually going to give a slightly different talk today. Firstly, I'd like to acknowledge my co-authors, Veronica Herrera, from MPI, the Ministry of Primary Industries in New Zealand. She's unfortunately not here. She has a problem that she's trying to fix in New Zealand, and that's Mycoplasma bovis. Travis Glear is also a co-author with me from the Bioprotection Research Centre at Lincoln University. He also has a problem. He fell off his mountain bike and is injured. So I can talk freely without, well, actually there's a few MPI people in the room, so maybe I can't talk too freely. I've put a line through Food National Science Challenge there and changed it to International. And we've had one talk from John, and I'd like to make some comments about the international side of it from New Zealand as we go through the talk. My talk is about our interaction with the CRC, but it's also more looking towards our interactions and collaborations with Australia in general. So here's a slide that was put up in the brown marmorated stink bug workshop that we had some time ago. And basically, it's there to point out that it makes absolute sense for New Zealand and Australia to work together in the biosecurity area. We have common issues that we are trying to stop, and when one of us gets those common issues, we have problems with each other. But think fire blight or fruit fly, something like that. But we can certainly help each other out, and I think we've been doing that in the CRC. This slide doesn't speak well to North America, so I do want to acknowledge the great interactions that we've had with Kansas State and this particular program, which you've heard about here in the program. Now, just a brief outline of my talk, as much for myself as anything. I'm just really going to go through some of the highlights as I see our involvement with the CRC has been. And that's from the Ministry's point of view, from Lincoln University's point of view as well. In some ways, it's sort of silly me getting up here and talking, because what do I say? Research, collaboration, and plant border biosecurity, plant biosecurity is a no-brainer. We should be doing it. And I could just about leave the stage at this particular point. But I'm going to go through some of the highlights. I do want to make the point, though, that Plant and Food and Lincoln University have been, and the Ministry of Primary Industries have been significant contributors to the CRC. Plant and Food and Lincoln University, I estimate, have put about $10 million into the program by the time it comes to the end. We've also had Kevin Marshall on the board. Veronica Herrera is on the RAP. Peter Silcock and Richard Palmer, who's here, have or are on the HAP. Grant Smith has been a long-time program leader for the biggest program in the CRC, and we have a number of project leaders over time. I'd also like to point out, and this is where I think this comes, we talk about the international view of the national science, of the CRC. In the last annual report, 27% of the peer-reviewed publications included New Zealand authors. And I did a quick count of the presentations at this meeting, and nearly 50% of them had some association with New Zealand. Now, if we add America onto that, you can see why I've put a line through national and changed it to international. We've also had MPI colleagues working on a lot of those projects as well. Now, briefly, I'm just going to look at a couple of projects that we've been involved with in the CRC. This is not all of them, and I apologize for those that I have not chosen today, but most of these talks you've seen. And I'm going to work backwards. Now, we've heard from Francesco Martini and Sillard Love. Now, it occurred to me that we could not come to a conference with an Italian speaking about love and limiting it to sillets. So I Googled the top five phrases of the language of love on the internet and have asked Francesco to speak to them in his lovely Italian language. I didn't think we could leave without that. So Francesco, here you go.
David, I'm gonna agree on this, but I'm also gonna add your name at the end of each sentence. So it's more heartfelt. So David, you tu sei l'unico per me, David, and non posso vivere senza di te, David. E ti penso sempre. Sei il mio eroe, David, this is actually true. And sono dipendente dai tuoi baci, David.
You know, I didn't understand a word of that. But really, Francesco, it's great to see your enthusiasm. And that's why, I wanted to
You're blushing,
maybe.
It worked.
One of the other projects that I think is really, really worthwhile highlighting is a talk that we already had today. And here's a comment from Callum Fletcher. I think we may have seen this today, but it really emphasizes that a lot of people have found very, very much use in this particular program. And the point that I sometimes make is that, and we heard it this morning actually, that in some cases New Zealand is ahead of Australia in terms of its interaction with its indigenous people, the Maori. Yet it was the CRC that funded the most significant project that we had in engagement in this area, and that's quite something. As you saw this morning, this particular program is a program of engagement is being used fairly effectively in a number of different situations. The market access program that Lisa Jameson spoke about, one of the concerns, I think, that when we came into the CRC was that we couldn't work in the area of market access because of the trade implications there. But Lisa and her team from a number of different organisations have proved that wrong. And this is a great project that's gone ahead. And indeed, Lisa was awarded the Collaboration Award last year at the conference for her leadership of that programme. So that was another highlight for me from New Zealand. We heard also from Karen Armstrong talking this morning about, well, I think it was this morning, I sort of get lost in all the talks that we've had. This morning, Karen? Yes, it was, wasn't it? Yesterday. Sorry. But this really highlights another area that we looked at when coming into the CRC. We're looking at programs that we could actually build into a larger program. And I think this particular area was one of those areas of high risk. And some of those high risk programs need greater investment in than other programs because, they need that. And the CRC has really allowed Karen and her team again to follow some of the areas that that we wouldn't have been able to follow without that investment. And then innovation through collaboration. And this is something that I also would like to highlight. This is an age-old program, I guess, with databases. Scientists like to develop databases. And then the question is, what do you do with them? Who pays for them? How do you keep the information updated? And in one of our project meetings, one of our project team had a flash of inspiration and said, why don't you think about this? Why don't you follow this avenue? And so we're significantly along the way to developing a journal which we believe will provide this data and make it available for everybody and providing an incentive for people to keep uploading data to that and at the same time allow peer review of that data so we know it's really worthwhile. A couple of the other things that I'd like to highlight is the support of the two countries in terms of their relative incursions. So here we have New Zealand support for Australia in terms of the tomato potato psyllid and Liberiabacter. And we had quite a long, presentation of that from Grant Smith. And so New Zealand has helped out significantly with that particular incursion in Western Australia. And there's a quote from Sonia. I think I saw Sonia come back in the room. Sonia, thank you. And again, if we turn it around the other way, Australian support for New Zealand, actually this is something that hasn't been talked about at the conference that much, but the input that we've had from Australia for our myrtle rust incursion has been hugely appreciated by MPI, as indicated here. And we thank, there's a number of scientists and operational biosecurity professionals in this room that have helped New Zealand out. So that's been a huge benefit to New Zealand. Joint workshops, and here are a number of them that have been going on over the years, supported by the CRC, and sometimes otherwise. So I think New Zealand got a lot out of the Xylella workshop in 2016. The fruit fly workshop, I think Barry O'Neill said that was one of the best workshops that he's ever been to. The myrtle rust workshop that was run in conjunction with the CRC was also hugely beneficial. That was just before myrtle rust occurred in New Zealand. And then we had a myrtle rust symposium after the incursion. And again, we had support from Australian researchers there. And then most recently, we had a BMSB workshop in Brisbane. So I think there have been huge gains from having that interaction between scientists and others at those workshops. I do want to emphasize science. I do think sometimes we are so focused on impact that we forget that actually we are the ones that are doing the science and that we need to encourage that. And I've put up a slide here of some of the scientific outputs that one of the programs that we were dealing with. These came out of that project. Now, here's a list of benefits. How am I going for time? Good. So I will go through them one by one, but there are others, and I've touched on some of these. So what are the benefits of being in the CRC? So they've developed some great trans-Tasman and trans-Pacific research teams. And there has been this enhancement of cultural engagement, and I'm talking specifically about the Indigenous Engagement Program, but I guess you could also consider the cultural interactions between Australians and New Zealanders and Australians and Americans as well. But primarily, that Indigenous Engagement Program has been wonderful. I talked about combined resources to develop projects of size. That's been pretty important to us. And then shared expertise from specialized teams. And we've seen that in a number of programs where a specialized group from one country can help a specialized group, a more general group in another country. There's been the development of standardized protocols and tools for use in operational situations. And of course, the production of a range of science, implementation, engagement, outcomes and outputs. Shared operational and research support for new incursions. And one of the things that probably isn't spoken about is that the opportunities provided for professional development of staff has been one of the things that we've really valued out of the CRC. I've left the last bullet point somewhat removed from the first because I think it's something that we haven't actually achieved, but are still looking towards, and that is a regional approach to biosecurity. And it goes back to my first slide, which is here. It's a no-brainer that we should be working together in this area. And I've developed this DNA visual to sort of try and see some of the synergies that we're looking at. So we have government, we have research, we have cross-sectoral institutions, and we have sector-to-sector interactions. So we can think about the glue, this is a bit dangerous here, isn't it? Here, between those, and we can all work on those together. We can think about the backbone of what's holding the various parts of the biosecurity system together in our own countries. And then we can think of something outside of that where we can join together and work across that whole biosecurity system. And that's something that we've been thinking about in the last months. So back to the last slide, thank you very much. But I think, you know, what we have here is an international science exchange, not a national science exchange. Thank you very much.